Thank you very much for coming. I'd like to welcome members of the audience and our panelists as well to this forum on climate-proofing New York. So we're here to discuss today what New York should do to prepare for climate change. There's now widespread recognition that climate change is occurring and that it's going to continue to occur regardless of whether we reduce our greenhouse gas emissions. And in the wake of Hurricane Sandy, there's been much discussion about what New York needs to do to prepare itself for climate change. So today we've got a panel of experts who are here to hopefully talk to us and enlighten us about ideas for adapting New York to deal with climate change. So I'm just going to briefly introduce the panelists. We've got here on my right Malcolm Bowman, who's a professor of physical oceanography and a distinguished service professor at the Marine Sciences Center at Stony Brook. I've got here on my left Stuart Gruskin, who's Chief Conservation and External Affairs Officer at the Nature Conservancy in New York, and Courtney Worrell, who's the Chief Operating Officer at the Metropolitan Waterfront Alliance. We have a fourth panelist who hasn't arrived yet, Eddie Bautista, who's the Executive Director of the New York City Environmental Justice Alliance. Okay, so I'm going to start off by asking our panelists a question, and that will give people an opportunity to each person on the panel will have an opportunity to answer the question, and then we'll hopefully get into a fairly good free-flowing exchange. Okay, so the question I wanted to start off with is the basic question, the central question of our panel: what should New York be doing to adapt to climate change? So, Malcolm, do you want to start, begin?
Well, thank you, Katrina. As you said, I'm an oceanographer, a physical oceanographer. That means I study things like weather, tides, tsunamis, hurricanes, ocean currents, all that sort of thing. So that's a very interesting question. It's a very complicated question. Climate change is real. Believe me, it's real. It's getting worse. It's very scary. It's not going to go away anytime during your lifetime. It's just going to get worse. So what should New York City do? I think it has to do a multitude of things, and that depends partly on how long we look into the future or what kind of threat we want to protect the city against. You want me to go any further?
Or? Yeah, why don't you talk a bit about the idea of the threat index and sort of then go into the storm surge barriers.
Since Sandy, there's been a multitude of ideas and opinions about what the city should do and Long Island, New Jersey should do to protect itself, and it seems that there's a lot of talking past each other. You know, on one hand, you might say we have engineers on one side who look down their nose at environmentalists, and on the other side, there are the environmental community who sort of have a great suspicion of damage done by hard solutions in the past. And so it seems like I see myself as belonging to both those camps. I teach both oceanography and environmental science. And so how do we breach that philosophical void? So I come up with the idea of what I call a threat index. If the leaders of our city and state, cities and states, could agree on, one, we must never let this catastrophe of Sandy ever happen again. Two, what is the threats that we, and what are the risks and the cost of protecting against those risks that that implies? For example, what the Europeans use a 1-in-1,000-year threat index. What does that mean? Does that mean that there won't be a storm for like this for another 1,000 years? No, it does not. It just simply means that this year and next year, there's a 1-in-1,000 chance that it will happen. Sounds small, but actually it isn't. If that, we can think of that as the threat, the gold standard. If that's too much for people to get their heads around, well, what about a 1-in-500-year storm threat? And then we can work our way down, 1-in-250 years, 1-in-100 years, you might say Sandy and Irene were 1-in-100-year storms, then 1-in-50, 1-in-25, and there are different solutions in different places for all those threats. So I think the leaders, by that I mean Cuomo, I mean Bloomberg, I mean Christie, if they could agree, like the Europeans have done, one, it must never happen again, and two, we will protect our beloved cities against a 1-in-1,000-year storm, then we can start talking about how to do that.
And did you want to maybe talk a bit about the storm surge idea? These are the...
Okay. Very quickly, this is a what's called a worst-case scenario for flooding of Metro New York. Can you read that from where you are? under a hypothetical category four, a bit unrealistic, category four, this latitude, hurricanes start in the tropics, they fade away as they go north. But this could be the picture that a category two, say 25, 50 years from now might look at like. The blue areas are areas that are prone to flooding, and it's not surprising, it's those areas that are very low lying. New York City, Metro New York, is built on sort of marshy land, going back to colonial times. Do you want me to just change it? I was privileged to go to the Netherlands in January with a film crew from News One TV?
New York One.
New York One, and we spent 4 days in the Netherlands, that country that 25% of the land is underwater, is below sea level, and what they have done, they had a huge flood in 1953 that drowned thousands of people, and they decided at that point this must never happen again. Most of the coastline is actually protected by sand dunes, and that's what you see up the upper half of the picture. But and I'm just going to show you where that red arrow is how they enhance the sand dunes. And then the ports and the industrial areas and the river mouths are protected by what they call storm surge barriers. So it's a combination of solutions, and there are many forms of protection inside the country. Both Amsterdam and Rotterdam, two major cities, are 6 to 9 feet below sea level. Their major airport is the fourth busiest in Europe. It's below sea level. So they don't mess around. It's national security. It's survival at stake. This is one of their solutions that were built after the 1953 flood. And what you're looking at is a sort of an elevated highway, but it's you can see it's open. You see the tide coming in, so tide goes in and out. But there are gates there that they slam shut if a big surge from the North Sea is coming in. And the industrial areas and the port areas, this is a big sort of saloon door gate. It's as you can see, it's large, but that protects the port of Rotterdam, which is the largest seaport in the world, and the city of Rotterdam. It's very rarely used. It's only been used once in 10 years since it was opened. But it's there, and they find it critical. This is just going back to what you might call natural protection. I'm standing on top of a enhanced sand dune. It's about 30 feet high. It's very wide. It's got seagrasses growing on top. You can see on some little buildings there, that's concessions at the beach. So we're looking at the English Channel North Sea to the left, and to the right is, you'll see in the next picture, is a little village. It's got a funny name. It's called Monster. And you can see there's this lovely little Dutch village, these neat red houses. You can see windmill right in the center there in the background. You can see City Hall or a church or something. And the city is very, very safe and secure, but they've traded the view for security. So that's a decision they've made that if they're going to live there safely, if they're going to raise their families there, then they cannot, they're below sea level. So they don't mess around. But these sand dunes, and they're not like levees, they're like sort of a gently sloping, that takes care of them. Well, what to do about New York City? And this now depends on the kind of threat we're going to be talking about, this, that we want to protect against. And one solution that I've been looking at, not to be built this year, next year, but maybe 25 years from now, but to study, is a series of a causeway, an elevated highway from Sandy Hook, New Jersey, across to Far Rockaway, and then curling around enhanced sand dunes with a highway associated with around Kennedy Airport, and a second one by the Upper East River there. What for? To stop major surges like Sandy from ever sort of causing the trouble that Sandy caused. And that's just a few slides up to get the discussion rolling. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. Stu, do you want to start with what you would advocate New York City should do to adapt to climate change?
Sure. So, good afternoon, everyone. You might expect, since I'm with the Nature Conservancy, that I would just be saying, green solutions, soft solutions, natural systems. It's actually a little bit more complicated than that. The first thing we need to do is acknowledge that the threat is real. We know the climate is changing. It's time to stop arguing about whether it's changing, but we have to deal with it. I think the next step is to recognize that there is a mix of solutions. This is a complicated problem, and I say mix and not balance, because this is not a situation where we should be saying, well, let's balance the gray and the green. Instead, it's a situation where we have to look comprehensively at the nature of the threat, the the areas that are being impacted and are vulnerable and try to figure out what the best solution is for those areas. And in some instances, it should be natural systems. In other instances, we will need to build things. In some instances, we'll need to build things that mimic natural systems. And at other times, we may have to do all of it. But we have to recognize that there is no silver bullet. We can't just do something tomorrow that's going to solve all of the climate risks. And storm surge is only one of them, right? That there are many other kinds of severe weather risks, including drought, floods. And so storm surge is sort of the focus of attention, but that's not the only thing that we ought to be thinking about. I think it's critically important, though, that we recognize that the natural systems approach has equal standing with built systems. And that is a change in the way of thinking, that traditionally people have looked at responding to these kinds of threats by building something. And what we have to do is acknowledge that the same forces of nature that could be causing this harm can also be used as a way of strengthening our communities and protecting us. So the starting point for the conversation has to be recognizing that all of the options are on the table for consideration. And that was, I think, one of the most significant conclusions in the 2100 Commission report, which I had the opportunity to work on. And this was right after Sandy, Governor Cuomo convened a commission that was comprised of primarily business leaders, leaders from energy, transportation, finance, insurance, and really only one or two environmental groups. And so the Nature Conservancy participated. And if you go and look, you could Google it, 2100 Commission, you'll find the report. And it does talk about the importance of these green solutions being of the same standing with the built solutions. And that flows into policy decisions and funding decisions. I think that we have to be careful that in our zeal to build something, right, we want to protect ourselves, that we recognize that building something is not always going to deal with all of the risks, and that we should not subordinate the other options because of the sense of security that we get. So for example, while a wall might help with the storm surge, it's not going to help if we get 14 inches of rain. And the water that's blocked in one place is going to go some other place. So there are a lot of complex issues with this, and there's a cost-benefit issue as well. We also need to put on the table the policy options. One of those now that's being talked about is the idea of a buyout where people want to be bought out, and recognizing that there are just some places that are too vulnerable for people to live, and we ought to be looking at our land use policies and determining whether is it a better use of public money to help people relocate in those places as opposed to building something that's likely to get washed away again. And then finally, it's really important that we provide tools and information and the ability to make better decisions to our community leaders. And one of the things the Nature Conservancy did was develop a web-based tool called Coastal Resilience that allows for modeling of things like marsh migration and shows the vulnerabilities of communities so that as people are making decisions, they take into account the need for climate adaptation. And I think this all end with making the point that we need to factor into all of our decision making about spending government money, about land use planning, other government policy decisions, the idea that the climate is changing and that's going to have a lot of impacts in a lot of different ways, and it should be included in the review process for those decisions.
Okay, thanks. Eddie, do you
want to? Sure. Before I begin, I wanted to thank NYU and Katrina for inviting me to speak. I'll be honest, when I first got the message that someone named Katrina was inviting me to talk about Sandy, I thought it was a gag, so I just wanted to thank Katrina for her patience in my reluctance in returning her call. I'm Eddie Bautista. I'm the executive director of the New York City Environmental Justice Alliance. That's a citywide coalition of community-based organizations from the city's most environmentally overburdened communities. We were founded in 1991 as the environmental justice movement started taking off in New York City. The alliance came together in part because even though each neighborhood was getting increasingly successful at their local environmental justice battles, mostly siting battles, what became clear was that the root causes of these issues were systemic. And in order for these community groups to be able to address the root causes and deal with city and state policies that were leading to not just disproportionate burdens, but lack of environmental amenities, we realized that we needed to kind of come together and fight from a united perspective. It's kind of like the Avengers, right? Those fights that Thor and Iron Man and Hulk can't fight. And I'm gonna stop doing that joke. It falls flat every single time. I keep trying. I guess stubbornness is also resilience. I'm stubbornly trying to get laughs every single time with it. So our connection to this issue predates Sandy, predates Irene, predates the three tornadoes that hit Brooklyn, predates countless nor'easters, predates microbursts. Our connection goes back actually to the 90s. In the late 90s, New York City launched its coastal revision of its coastal zone management plan. In New York City, it's called the Waterfront Revitalization Program. The coastal zone management plan essentially divvies up the waterfront into like four basic areas. And the activities allowed in those areas are measured against the coastal zone management plan. So if you're a developer looking to build something in an area that's designated a natural section of the waterfront, obviously you can't, right? There was a classification added to the working waterfront designation called significant maritime and industrial areas. And this one, okay. Trying to do the build up before I show them the slide. So for us, the concern about these designations were that the SMIAs, the significant maritime industrial areas, were essentially city policy sanctioning the clustering and concentration of the city's heaviest industrial and infrastructure uses. Now, let me preface what I'm about to say by saying, our movement is not an anti-industrial movement. On its surface, these designations were essentially industrial retention policies, and we consider ourselves very much industrial retention advocates as well. Partly because if you look at the kinds of jobs that the manufacturing sector offers, our opinion, our feeling is it has to be some places in this town that working class people can still work and get paid a decent wage for a living. So, for example, the Economic Development Corporation did an analysis a few years ago, and of course it's a broad range of jobs that fall in this, but the bottom line is that the median annual income for manufacturing jobs in New York is about $60,000 a year. And so if you're looking at the kinds of work opportunities that communities that are not exactly college bound have at their disposal, 60 grand a year is not that bad, right? But we're also staunch environmental advocates, and we believe that this paradigm of economic development means environmental sacrifice is an old paradigm. It no longer works, can't work, and that in fact environmental protection and economic development are not only not inconsistent, but in fact need to coexist, right? So we started looking at these significant maritime industrial area classifications, and we started trying to develop reforms for these designations to be thoughtful, so that we're not looking at, again, codifying the disproportionate environmental burdens that these communities had faced for years. But if you remember who was running New York City in the late 90s, I will say that the only thing the Giuliani administration was more hostile to than environmental protection was civil rights. And you try to combine those two things and we were dead in the water. So, and of course, we weren't able to win our SMI reforms. Fast forward 10 years, Bloomberg administration launches its next revision, the Coastal Zone Management Plan. And with a more enlightened administration, one that's obviously committed not only to public health, but sustainable environmental practices, we thought we would have another shot. And so we started looking at the SMIAs, but what we had in 2010 that we didn't have in the late 90s were climate change analyses and toolboxes. So this is what we found. This is a map, obviously, of the city's waterfronts, and the dotted lines that you'll see are the city's significant maritime and industrial areas. There are six of them. From top to bottom, it's the South Bronx, Newtown Creek, which, by the way, is one of the two recently designated federal Superfund sites in New York. Brooklyn Navy Yard, Red Hook, Sunset Park, and North Shore of Staten Island. What was, I guess, probably in hindsight shouldn't have surprised anyone, but what was stunning to us was how every single one of these significant maritime industrial areas were vulnerable to storm surges. The orange that you see are our GIS overlays on top of the SMIAs. Before I get to that, just explain the dotted line is a half mile buffer outside of the SMIAs. The black contoured lines are the actual SMIAs. We decided to do an additional buffer to kind of look at, we just use the usual kind of CEQA, the State Environmental Quality Review Act, standard for measuring environmental impacts. It's usually a half a mile, so we decided to see what it would look like if we drew a half mile buffer around the SMIAs. The orange, the overlay that you see, the orange portions of the map, are storm surge projections based on the New York State Office of Emergency Management. And so, of course, as you can see, you know, forget Category 4, you know, Category 1, nor'easters, we're vulnerable, extremely vulnerable all sorts of severe weather events. So we decided to go even deeper and start examining some of the states and cities' environmental databases. And what we did was these are all public databases. We started doing additional overlays, and we produced over 100 maps. If you're not, I'm only going to show you two more. This is a map of the SMI for the South Bronx. This is a map, those purple dots indicate the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation's database for chemical bulk storage. Basically, these are facilities that are permitted to handle up to 400,000 gallons of oil. About 17% of the city's entire permitted facilities are located in the South Bronx, a community that has maybe 6% of the city's entire population. There are all, like I said, literally dozens of maps that show these clusters and how vulnerable they are to these SMIAs. I do want to point out that black square that you see, that is the Hunts Point Food Terminal Market, the nation's largest food distribution center. It's where I can throw all kinds of statistics. Let me give you one. 70% of the entire region's produce is handled through that spot. Right? Had the storm surge, had Sandy coincided with high tide for the New England, for the Long Island Sound, we would have seen a surge that would have overrun the South Bronx. And I mean, this is even according to the mayor's office, had the timing coincided just a little differently. And remember, look how close the Hunts Point Food Terminal Market is to those huge chemical storehouses. And that's just one database, folks. There are a lot of other heavy industrial uses there. If you think the fights over the gas lines were bad, try cutting off the food supply to the region. This is serious stuff. And, well, let me just skip. Did we give you the home? This is just a map of the entire breakdown of census population, essentially, of the number of New Yorkers that live within a half mile and are vulnerable to storm surge in the SMIAs. It's about 622,000 New Yorkers. Of those, 433,000 are people of color. We've got a bunch of other, you know, linguistically isolated seniors. There's a number of other vulnerable population indicia that maps, you know, and as I guess it's no surprise to anyone, closely to this. This is a map of the storm surge as it hit the Red Hook SMIA. If you guys know Brooklyn, this, these are the warehouses across the street from Fairway. As you could tell, these are daylight hours. You could see there are lampposts, street lights, and usually where the bay ends is right at the end where you see that walkway in the back. Again, daylight hours, and this is hours before the worst of Sandy hit. As you can see, the storm surge is sweeping through what is a building that has about 98% vacancy, 98% occupancy rate of mostly light manufacturing uses. I'll stop there, but from our perspective, the issue of storm surge represents, when you look at from an environmental justice perspective, a clear and present danger that we've been urging the city since 2010 to grapple with. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Courtney, what do you advocate the city should do to adapt to climate change?
All right, well, let me just do a little introduction. I'm sure. Courtney Worrell from the Metropolitan Waterfront Alliance. We're an organization with over 700 businesses, consulting firms, volunteer organizations, and nonprofits that are all committed to the revitalization of the New York City waterfront. So we've been working on this for a long time. And in terms of what the city can do, I just want to put a plug in the question about what the city should do about climate change. I won't talk about this extensively at all, but I want to make the plug for mitigation and adaptation going hand in hand. So that I think that's very important. And in terms of what New York City should be doing about storm surges and coastal flooding related to hurricanes or other types of events, one thing is that we're very encouraged by the work that New York City is doing right now. They have committed to a program called the Special Initiative for Rebuilding and Resiliency. Mayor Bloomberg announced it a few weeks after the hurricane hit, and the final report will be coming out in May. And we've gotten a little preview of it, and it looks like it's been done very, very well. I think one of the reasons why it's done well is that it's involved an enormous amount of staff time. The New York City has reorganized itself for this temporary project, and many people at the top level of agencies in the city have been working on it. And the reason why that's important is it's a very complex problem, and we have to have, when you're working on a complex problem, good minds need to have enough time to think about it and figure it out. The agencies have also been talking to each other, and that's a very important thing. We have siloed agencies in the city, just like we do everywhere, and they need to know what the other person is doing. They need to know what expertise there are in other agencies and what can be done. That looks like that's been happening very well. We also know that the city has been talking to a lot of organizations such as Nature Conservancy, Eddie's Group, and others to find out what their best ideas are for coastal flooding. So what we know from what the city wants to commit to, at least now, the funding though is a big question, how to pay for all this. But there's a commitment to a very wide range of solutions. Everything from a few seawalls that they're thinking about near the Rockaways, but also many green solutions, and something also, which is pretty interesting, removable flood walls. There are a couple companies that do make flood walls that can be installed in anticipation of a storm, and that way they don't ruin the quality of life or the look of a neighborhood. And the question, though, with flood walls is that are removable is where to store them, who installs them. It's a similar problem that the police department has with installing police barricades during parades and that type of thing. So it takes an entire infrastructure to do that, but it's one solution. So anyway, we're really encouraged by what we see. I think that one of the larger recommendations that we've had for a long time, and that is now even more apparent, is the city does need better governance of the waterfront. And with this plan that's going to come out in May from the city, it's clear that there's a question of who's going to implement it, who's going to put this in place. There's not one agency committed to climate change. There's no one agency committed to the waterfront. So we've been advocating for a long time for a Department of the Waterfront for New York City, where most of the waterfront jurisdictional issues, maintenance, repair, long-term planning can go into one agency and there can be coordination and good implementation. And I just want to say also, though, that there have been many things that are needed for the waterfront and we've seen as important for the waterfront for a long time, before the hurricane. What the key word here is revitalization of the New York City waterfront. We have a waterfront that has been changing rapidly over the last 50 years. Much of the port activity that was in New York City has been relocated over time to New Jersey, and that left a lot of open land that can be used for a whole host of things. Now, what are we going to do with that land? Well, what we've been working on for the last 10 years or so, and 5 years as an independent organization, is bringing more boats, more ferry service, more waterfront parks, more areas of the city that are preserved for natural uses, so wetlands preservation. But also, importantly, we have to protect the industrial areas of the city, like Eddie mentioned, and we have to notice that there still are very important port activities that go on in the city that support the overall port activities in New Jersey. There's a symbiotic relationship there. And all of those priorities are still as important now as they were before the hurricane, but we can't lose sight of them.
Thank you very much. So one idea that a number of you discussed was the idea of building storm surge barriers or seawalls. And Malcolm, you were the most favorably inclined for this idea of the people who kind of alluded to it on the panel, and I think you're widely seen in the press as kind of an advocate for this idea. So I was wondering if you could sort of maybe respond to some of the critiques that I guess, Stu, you made of the idea of storm surge barriers. Maybe you want to start by kind of restating this, some of the concerns you expressed, and then Malcolm.
Can we address them? Well, without taking a position on whether a storm surge barrier might or might not be appropriate in a particular place, storm surge barriers are designed for one type of purpose, which would be to guard against surge. There are other threats that a storm surge barrier would not help with. So I think if we're going in and going to be spending some potentially tens of billions of dollars on taking this kind of step, then we should recognize what we're actually going to be accomplishing. There are some other issues with storm surge barriers. There are environmental impacts that have to be taken into account, and you know, doing the permitting for it would require a look at all of that, the impact on not just the aquatic environment, but also the impacts on other places. And as I think I mentioned before, that if the water hits the wall, it's going to go somewhere else, and it's going to impact other communities. And one way it was described to me is that you could have a storm surge barrier that might protect Lower Manhattan, but it could actually cause flooding in other areas that may not be as wealthy. And it's, you know, to say, well, the cost-benefit analysis is that the damage in Lower Manhattan is going to be so much greater than the damage in some other community, which may be a community that's already disproportionately burdened. That's not a good way of making public policy. So I think that from an engineering and science and public policy standpoint, and the question of how do you spend public dollars most effectively, that there are issues that need to be addressed if you're going to look at storm surge proposals.
No one's proposing that storm surge barriers be constructed this year, next year, or even in the next maybe 25 years. But now is the time to start studying all the effects that Stuart just talked about. If we had a barrier system like I showed in that slide for New York City in place, I have to tell you, there would be no flooding damage within that circle of protection from Sandy. That doesn't mean to say there would be damage. Of course, there'd be damage on the South Shore, Long Island, down the Jersey coast. Stuart also mentioned the question of what you might call sidewash. If you put up a barrier suddenly, that storm surge has to go somewhere, and it's going to may cause damage elsewhere. That's the question that I receive. That's the most common question I receive. Now, I'm a fluid dynamicist, and I study these questions closely. We model these problems. And it's not really the case. So you could talk to the Dutch, to the Russians, to the British about this, because what happens is that we have very excellent weather forecasts these days. If there's a hurricane coming up the East Coast, you know it a couple of days beforehand, and you would close the gates at the low tide before the surge hits. That means the water is 6 feet lower than it might otherwise be. And then the barrier, the surge that's driven by the winds from far offshore, it senses that the barrier is there, and that surge doesn't come in. This is not a lesson in fluid dynamics now, but it's not as serious as Stuart makes out. So I'm saying now is the time to start planning and looking at all the pros and cons. Of course, there are many issues. There are engineering issues, there are environmental issues, there's social justice issues, legal. I was interested in Eddie's maps. I mean, they're very dramatic and scary when you're starting to mess with the danger with the food supply of the city or the water supply of the city. But it's interesting, the New York City maps always leave out New Jersey, you know, and it's as if it's another planet. It does not exist, and yet New Jersey is in a worse situation than New York in terms of its low elevations. You think of the Hackensack Meadows, you think of Port Elizabeth, you know, Newark Airport. So we have to look at this as a regional solution, and nature does not recognize any political boundaries. So dealing with New York City, that's always a gray area that you showed, Eddie, and it's a strange thing. Just one other little point about Mayor Bloomberg's people are claiming that in the next 20, 30 years, the population of the city is going to increase by 1 million. And most of those immigrants will be people probably in lower socioeconomic classes. If you look at the outer boroughs of Brooklyn and Queens, 2 to 3 million people live less than 6 feet above sea level, you know, and when the orders come to evacuate, when the public transportation shut down, as it has to be to park the buses, subways, and trains, how are those people going to evacuate? Have you ever tried walking across Brooklyn? It'd take you about 5 days. you know, pushing granny in the wheelchair and a baby strapped to your back. So these are big issues of evacuation, how to handle all these. We often think of Manhattan as the area most at risk, but I keep saying, you know, we have to look at those outer boroughs.
I'm not going to opine on specific barriers. I mean, I think it is complicated, and I think it's a kind of conversation that, you know, you can't preempt. You need to at least have something specific to react to, right? You can't really, and I'm not an engineer. I'm even less a fluid dynamicist. I'm none of those things. I have heard, you know, some of Stu's concerns, which is, you know, storm surge is essentially a wave of not just water and wind, but it's energy, right? And energy, you know, doesn't, for basic physics, right, doesn't disappear. It's going to get redirected in some way. But I think it begs the question of further analysis. And I think that's what's interesting, though, is, and Malcolm's point is correct about, you know, storms don't respect, you know, political boundaries, right? And that's one of the reasons why we drew those contours, because, you know, those SMIAs, nothing's going to stop at the end of that, you know, contour, right? About a month after Sandy hit, we convened, I think, the first regional environmental justice summit on December 1st. We had not just the folks from our community-based organizations, but from some of the lowest income and some of the hardest hit communities across the region. So Jersey was there, folks from Newark, Lower East Side, Coney Island. And at that summit, it was pretty powerful. It was the first time people had left their neighborhoods since Sandy hit. And as people were sharing experiences, they realized that we needed to, our movement has a saying, which is, if you're not at the table, you're probably on the menu, right? So we realized that with Sandy's recovery, the $50 billion, which by the way is no longer $50 billion, no, people aren't recognizing because of sequestration. We're really talking about 47, 46 billion. So the circus continues in D.C. But we realized that with that amount of money coming in and literally decades of rebuilding and recovery work, we needed to get our act together. On January 26th, we convened a large, what we're now calling the Sandy Regional Assembly. Close to 200 people from the five boroughs, Long Island, Jersey, came together. We're about to release the outcome of those. We got like 25 pages of just brainstorming. We're going to release that agenda next week with the intent on sharing this agenda with the mayor's office, governors, and the federal task force. I will tell you what was pretty striking that day is, out of those nearly 200 people, like one person talked about the storm barriers. And this was after, that was kind of like right after, a few weeks after Sandy, that was where the real kind of attention was being paid on this. So it was just a striking thing that, it, for whatever reason, I don't know whether it just hadn't, you know, penetrated people's consciousness in our communities, or whether people, a lot of our recommendations were more in the line of green infrastructure and more, you know, building out more natural barriers and buffers to, again, absorb the energy that comes from storm surges. But I just found it interesting that only one person mentioned it.
Yeah, so we also need to talk about some of the things that can be done at a much smaller scale. For example, elevating buildings, smaller buildings onto stilts. Another is to make the basements and the first floors of buildings floodable. So that means that if they are flooded, they can come back online. That means critical infrastructure, so the boilers, the electrical systems, the communication, telecommunications need to be located on higher floors. We also need to, we can also be thinking about where generators are placed so that buildings can come back online if there's an overall power outage. The generators can be placed much higher. The fuel storage is a question, though, because the fire department requires fuel to be stored on the bottom levels, but that's something that can be worked out. There's also a great story to tell about how quickly, relatively quickly, this New York City subway system came back, especially in comparison to New Jersey. And part of that was because New York City has been doing so much more than New Jersey, tremendous amounts of work on climate change in comparison to New Jersey. And Governor Christie doesn't even really admit that climate change is real. It's that bad. And so there was a storage of New Jersey PATH trains in very flood-prone areas. And that's one of the reasons why it took a month or more, longer than that, for the New Jersey system to come back. The MTA, on the other hand, had been planning now for the last 3 years to come back online relatively quickly, and they could, save the South Ferry Station, which was a big disaster and still is. But it's an incredible success story. So when we're weighing these options, it's not like there aren't other things to do. It's not like storm surge barriers or green infrastructure. It's actually storm surge barriers, green infrastructure, and then many other engineering solutions that are done on a much smaller scale.
One idea that we haven't really touched on too much is the idea of managed retreat, or retreating from the coastline, maybe through rezonings or land use changes. You touched on it a little bit, Stu, in talking about the idea of voluntary buyouts that Governor Cuomo's kind of come out with. Maybe you want to maybe talk a bit about managed retreat, or what's happened to this idea?
Well, I'll say inherently it's controversial to be talking about people moving away from their homes. What happened, I think, after the storm, and this is, I will say that the idea of buyouts has been on the table before. FEMA has a program. There have been other places with kind of limited success. One of the problems is that, you know, anytime the government's going to give out money, it takes time to do. And for the people who are impacted by this, who are out of their homes, they don't have the luxury of time. They can't wait around for the government to, you know, take 2 years to issue checks to make decisions that about their lives. So I think in the past, buyouts have always been there kind of as an option and without a lot of political will behind them. But after Sandy, the governor came out and recognized that there are some places that are that nature is reclaiming, I think was sort of the way he put it. That should go back to nature. And let me say, it's not so easy to just like give something back to nature. But it does recognize that there are some places that the vulnerability has grown to the point where it doesn't make sense for people to live there anymore. So what do you do? And there are a host of policy and legal issues that are involved in that, but start with the premise that it's not the homeowner's problem, right? This is a bigger problem than just for the individual homeowner, and so it's gonna take government action of some sort to recognize that that solving the issue for that homeowner has gotta be done in a bigger way. The second thing is that whatever happens has to be done in a way that's going to strengthen communities and not weaken communities. So I think of this as the Swiss cheese effect. Can't offer buyouts and have a neighborhood where you have holes in the neighborhood because, you know, some people take it, some people don't, and then you end up with a weaker community. So that's not good. So you have to design a program that's going to get the critical mass that it's going to be able to be effective and provide incentives for communities to, for people to In the case of Staten Island, there's, I think, a 5% premium. If you stay on Staten Island, you have to target where it's going to be so that it's in the vulnerable areas, and you have to have willing participants. But once you do that, then I think you can structure a program where half the battle is figuring out how to get the money out to people fast enough so that it's going to do any good in the right ways, in the right places. And then the other half of the battle is what do you do with the new open space that's created? Right. If you have about 150 homeowners in this neighborhood in Staten Island who are interested in this, if they move out, you do have to answer the question of now what? And, you know, so that's another area, and that's an area that the Nature Conservancy is thinking about. And we have a history, really, and experience throughout the U.S. and other places in the world of doing restoration work and planning work. And it might be that there are some places where you could have recreational facilities that are built recognizing that floods are going to come and you can redo it. There's I was reading about a campground somewhere else in the U.S. where they know it's going to flood once a year. They just go in and, you know, fix it up again, and that's okay. Or you could have restoration work. You'd have a lot of different options, but it should be done with community engagement and should be done with a plan that's going to take best advantage of that property.
Now, Courtney, we were talking earlier about how the city is a bit ambivalent about the Governor Cuomo's buyout proposal.
We've heard this funny phrase that Americans don't retreat, they just attack in the opposite direction. And so the whole idea of retreat is just politically unpalatable in many, many ways. But we do know that there's a conflict between New York City and New York State in this area, as you might know, in many other topics. But, you know, Cuomo is advocating and is putting money into buyouts, and the Bloomberg administration's point of view is much more about rebuilding. So how that works out in the end, you know, we'll see what's going to happen. It'd probably be similar to what Stuart is talking about. I think that what's going to happen, though, is that if there's another storm that happens soon, there'll be more and more people that want to leave. And so a forced retreat or forced buyouts I think are politically unrealistic, and I think that it will happen over time naturally.
What's the basis for the city's opposition?
I haven't heard exactly what that is. I think that there's an interesting aspect to a lot of the homes that were damaged. And these are very middle class areas. These are not luxury waterfront homes, most of the ones that were hurt. And so there is a social aspect to this that's important. And I think that that's what Bloomberg is latching onto in many ways. I think it's just not an easy answer to tell people that they don't deserve to live here. And Bloomberg's closer to this politically than the governor is, for sure.
One direct reason why maybe not applicable to this neighborhood in the city, but in other places, the political leaders may not be fans of a buyout because you lose some of the tax base.
Yeah.
Right? If people leave, they're not paying real estate taxes anymore. And there are questions about who's going to own the land, right? Is it going to become state property, city property, town property, you know, county property? So, and this is something that's not just for New York City, but really needs to be discussed for any area where there's vulnerability. And alternatives are talking about building codes and, you know, local land use planning and, you know, those other kinds of things as well.
Well, and I just wanted to say also, just talking about Malcolm's point, which is really good, about establishing a threat index, I think one of the reasons we don't hear about that is that it's also politically unpalatable to talk about risk with the electorate. Who wants to be told that, which American out there wants to be told that they can't do what they want to do, and that if you build something, it might not actually last, or you might be a terrible risk? No politician's going to get up and talk about that. So I think that there is an overall understanding within the city of the people who are studying this that, yes, risk analysis is extremely important. But I don't think we're going to hear about it in the press very much at all.
So I'd like to open it up to the audience for questions. The event is being recorded, and so you should wait for a microphone to come to you. But if you do have questions, please lift up your hand and say who you are. Beginning. Up here.
Hi. Oh, I can stand. I'm Zaina. I'm a student here at NYU, and I just wanted to ask if someone could talk a little bit more about the sort of green or natural solutions that are being proposed at the moment.
I think that's yours, Stuart.
Okay. Well, so depending upon the area, there are going to be different options. So for example, talking about coral reef restoration is probably not a good option in New York City. On the other hand, talking about oyster reefs, which, you know, one time New York City had, you know, lots of oysters, is something that ought to be on the table for future discussion. One of the things I like about oyster reef restoration is that it's dependent upon the water quality being improved, and so we're not quite there yet with improving the water quality, but we should get there, and then we can look at oyster reefs as a way of breaking up the wave action before it gets onto the shore. And I'm less of a fluid dynamicist than Eddie is, even, or an engineer. I'm a lawyer, so engineering, forget about it. But I do know there's a difference when you talk about the impact of the waves coming in. One type of impact is the water. That's going to lead to floods, and the other is the force of the waves coming in. If you can break up that force of the waves further out by having reefs, whether they're natural or artificial, then that provides some protection. And there are all kinds of proposals for creating artificial reefs or using oysters and creating reefs in various places in New York that might break up the wave action. There are other places where you might be able to build up the dune system, and again, not necessarily in, you know, all of New York City, but in areas that were impacted by Sandy. And let's remember, we had severe flooding with Irene and in upstate areas. So, you know, apart from building something that's going to actually block or absorb water that's coming in the force of the water, you can also have wetland restoration and open space protection that basically acts as a sponge that would absorb the water and restore the natural systems to do what they're supposed to be doing to mitigate against flood events. So those are a couple of the kinds of options. You also throw in some mixed things like urban trees. even, you know, green infrastructure that's designed for the purpose of controlling stormwater runoff is a way of also helping address these sorts of issues.
And I'll just, add a thing. So the New York Harbor has been slated for restoration for quite a while now. The New York Harbor has been deepened far beyond its natural levels. It's also suffered from terrible water quality over almost 100 years or more. There's also extreme contamination in some areas. So there has been an effort to restore the New York Harbor. And what's great about the green infrastructure solution, the green solutions, is that they will also address that. And I think that's very important to understand, is that we get a double benefit in many, many ways.
Or more than the double.
We triple.
We call them co-benefits, because we don't want to just say double.
Right.
We think there's all kinds of benefits. And one of the issues with built systems, and again, not saying they are or not appropriate in certain places, because they are actually in some places, but typically they're designed for one purpose and require an investment and continued maintenance in a way that the green or natural system solutions don't.
Malcolm, I'm just curious, how would you, in light of your discussion of the threat index, how would you see sort of some of these natural solutions like oyster reefs or dunes?
Well, I think they're all important, but you have to be realistic about it. Like the experience in coastal Louisiana and Mississippi, you know, following Katrina, is that you need a huge area of wetlands to absorb a surge. And I hear figures like 15 miles wide to absorb a foot of surge. So it's not something that just growing a few seaweed fields around Manhattan is going to do very much at all. So it's all important. Of course it is, and it's all good, but we have to be realistic what we can stop and what we cannot stop. You know, every storm has its own signature, its own personality, and its own surprises. And so we're facing a new era in the climate where none of us have been before, and so we have to rely on our own experience, but we have to be prepared for the unexpected too, I think.
Right.
Thanks, everyone. I'm so heartened to hear about the coalitions and sort of collaboration between regional groups, and, you know, even acknowledging New Jersey, that sort of thing. I'm just sort of curious who you folks don't think are showing up at the table, and that might be targets of advocacy for us as New York City residents.
Just from my perspective, I differ slightly with Courtney about the mayor's process. There are a lot of people that are missing from the conversation. Some of them may still be operating this way, but some of the early SIRR, this kind of mayor's initiative to try to, you know, get people's input, was by invitation only, right? Like, if you didn't get invited, you weren't allowed to go in. I mean, that's just not. And then you had another. You've had some of these gatherings where you have like two impoverished communities and a privileged one. And the workshop covers the three communities, and it's in the privileged community. That was, in fact, the least of the three that was impacted, right? So but I think that by and large, one of the, as we get further away from Sandy and analysis deepens, we're starting to realize what the true impacts of Sandy were. I mean, Furman Center here in NYU just issued a study a couple of weeks ago that said that, you know, about half of the people that were impacted by Sandy were from households that made less than $30,000 a year, right? And I think that the homeowners were the most visibly hit, but as is the case when you're talking about disproportionate impacts, the people that are at the lower end of the economic scale are easier to miss in this. And one of the kind of ironies for us is, if you look at the public housing development in Far Rockaways, the people that are there, that development was created in part to allow for the displacement of people when Lincoln Center was built in Manhattan. So you got people displaced because of one urban removal project, They go out to the shoreline, and now there's talk about possibly, you know, them having to leave there as well. And so I think that part of the problem is, as you get deeper into the analysis of who is impacted by Sandy, the question becomes, how do you engage these communities? How do you engage a lot of immigrant workers that, in fact, were some of the first responders, right? These guys that rushed in and weren't given purposely, but they just weren't the information about how to protect themselves, and the cleanup wasn't good, right? So I think that we have to be intentional and thoughtful about how we engage everyone. And part of the problem is that there is a race to come up with the plans, whether it's the mayor's office coming up with one in May, the state and city action plans were just issued in the last couple of weeks. The state action plan gave about a week notice for what was like the first $1.7 billion. So it's how do you, I guess the question for us as a society is, how do we, how do we expeditiously move to a recovery, but at the same time do it thoughtfully? I mean, it's a hard balance to strike.
Yeah, I would agree, Eddie, actually, that the one thing the city plan does lack is any type of real public involvement process. But it's also correct that that's a very time-consuming process, and there wasn't time for the, well, the city felt that there wasn't time, and there probably weren't enough resources dedicated to that, because it also takes a lot of staff time to do that. I'd say in terms of the other groups that aren't maybe at the table as much as they should be, are the working waterfront, the port operations support services in the city. One thing we have to realize on the mitigation front is that if we lose port capacity in the city, we will have more trucks on the road, and the carbon emissions and the pollution levels from trucks making smaller deliveries as opposed to the larger ships is huge. And yet there is no way to take that into account. And we have a terrible situation happening right now on the north shore of Staten Island. There's a New York container terminal there is having trouble because of the toll increases. And this is something, it's not really hurricane related, but it is extremely important, and it's where mitigation and adaptation go hand in hand, and we have to commit to that.
I think your question also raises the issue of the availability of information, because there may be situations where people don't even know that they need to be at the table. So the people who are gonna get insurance bills because FEMA remapped where they live, and now it's going to cost them a fortune for insurance. They had no idea that that was going to happen. I think one of the lessons that we learned from this is that where there is information available, it's got to go out. And the point that was made earlier about politicians not necessarily wanting to talk about risk, it's a very good point, because you don't really. In my prior life at the Department of Environmental Conservation, I can tell you that there was information, there were maps that were done, and for political reasons, they were not released because they would have an impact on economic development in some areas, wetland maps, where people would need a special permit. So it was at that time, the decision, it wasn't really a decision, but the political reality was, well, let's not go out there with the maps because of the impact that it's going to have. So when I see, for example, the maps that Eddie put up, which are really powerful ways of communicating this information, you could try to go online and try to get some of that information from the various sources. Not always easy to do. So I think more tools for communities will be really important, and that's going to be one of the consequences. And if anyone's interested in that kind of stuff, if you go to coastalresilience.org, which is the mapping tool that we had put together at the Nature Conservancy, which was designed to be web-based so that any of you could go to it, and you could look at different scenarios for different types of storms over different periods of time. But there's also layers with the demographics, so you can see what types of communities are impacted, and layers with facilities, so you could see where there are facilities. The point that Eddie made about these potentially dangerous, fuel storage facilities and other facilities in vulnerable places is one of the untold stories of of vulnerability. But it is a critical issue, but no one is going to know unless they can go and see it on the map. And unless you make it easy to do that, they're not going to be at the table.
And I will say just one last thing about, there is a fallacy that somehow the city has to be the one to go around and do the planning. And what what that presupposes that these communities haven't already had their own charrettes. Or, I will tell you that several, there's a portion of the city charter called 197A that empowers community boards to develop their own plans. I personally know of three or four of these 197A plans that were developed in the 2000s where already adaptation and resiliency was becoming part of. So there are one or two, at least one or two of these 197A plans that specifically talk about adaptation measures in these waterfront communities. The city's not going back to, so there's a reinventing of the wheel in part because if the city's controlling the debate and the conversation, no one knows what these different SAR workshops, and there's no commitment by the city to tell New Yorkers, this is what people said at these workshops. All of it is one way, that information's coming, and then the city's gonna take that, develop a plan in May, and there's gonna be no way of knowing what low-lying fruit they decided to pick from and ignore. And that's part of the problem, is that if there are communities that have already done some analysis and done some planning, why not, you know, pick from some of those sources, right? Especially if it's a plan that had to go through some public review.
Questions? Maybe some from behind.
Hi, Denise. I have a comment on what Eddie just said and a question. Yeah, the low-hanging fruit. The entity known as MOS, the Municipal Arts Society, which is a wonderful organization, they were the folks that were very much involved with volunteers with what should have been a citywide community effort. So to get probably a better picture for those who are interested, and we all should be very interested, contact MOS before you go to the city. In 1978, which was maybe a really good year, because that's when the state put together a group of politicos to look at what a Irene would do, what a Sandy would do. And year after year, they would convene and they would put out reports. And then those reports in 06 and 010 started to use the word urgent. Whoever on the panel is familiar with these reports and would like to speak to why Cuomo post-Sandy said, well, like to kind of paraphrase, we really wouldn't have known what to do with them, which as far as I'm concerned, I'm a business person and I believe truly in the economy and the environment being mutually inclusive. That's a lot of crap. We knew this was coming for too many decades, and the politicos, as Stu knows, he was at DEC. He worked right there with Granis. Ignore and ignore and ignore. Thank you.
Okay, so I have something to say about that. I think part of that is that the national debate on climate change is in its infancy still. And so it's hard for politicians to go out and talk about it, and it's really hard for the agencies. Bob Yarrow, who is the executive director of the Regional Plan Association, said before the hurricane that it takes two disasters for people to wake up and understand and accept the fact that climate change or any other type of reality is happening. And we've had two now, so I think things are changing.
So it's a good question because there's no doubt about it. There's been plenty of information out there. When I was at DEC, we put out the Sea Level Rise Task Force report. It was one of the very last things that came out at the end of 2010 that was pretty clear about what the impacts of sea level rise would be. We've had no shortage of emergency management drills and reports and so on. But it is very hard to get that to translate into political action. The Sea Level Rise Task Force report was mandated by the legislature, came out with specific recommendations, and then immediately got shelved because every decision that's going to be made at the state level with this stuff, there's money that's going to get taken away from something else. And you know, I think that the question of political willpower ultimately starts with the voters, with the people. And you know, so some of that is getting the information out. Some of it's letting your representatives know that you care about these issues. But you know, I could list all these really expensive environmental problems that we know everything there is to know about it, and not anything is being done about it. That's the nature of our system.
I got to agree with Stu. I mean, just one clear example in terms of the transition from the Patterson administration to the Cuomo administration, there was a climate change adaptation plan that was put together that took, you know, a year. It was, you know, convened by, you know, all the state agencies, a large number of external stakeholders. I know because I was one of them, and in fact, the advisory group advised that we move the date of the when a governor would sign that action plan from the end of the Patterson administration to 3 months into the Cuomo administration to make sure that the incoming governor would, the governor never signed it. And this plan was given to him in what, 2011, 2012, I forget. So, and then when I heard about the 2100 commission, I forget the number of the commission, it was mind-boggling to me because I was like, wait a minute, the state went through this whole process. Why are they not, and I'm assuming that they did, but you know, there was a bunch of hard work that went into this that wasn't acted on. And I think that part of the problem is Stu hit it right on the head. It's about money, right? So for example, the Bloomberg administration, it's hard, and I could say this because I directed city legislative affairs for the Bloomberg administration in the second term, and there's nothing quite like doing this work when times are flush. When the city had you know, not deficits, but actual, you know, we had extra money, that was when we came up with Plan YC 2030. I can't think of a better time to plan and direct money than when you're sitting pretty on. But what happened was years into that, you know, after like when the third term hit, we had this enormous recession, and one of the great ironies is the Bloomberg administration tussling with the state government over the sea level rise report, because it was no longer a flush situation for the city, and they recognized that what they would be on the hook for was very expensive mitigation efforts for the. So all of a sudden, the very administration that was like the lead on sustainability was now in a defensive posture over a sea level rise report that they were saying, and they would never say this publicly, but we know behind the scenes it was about the bottom line. So yeah, what frustrates all of us is the problem of this is a political system, and at bottom you have politicians and limited budgets, and those things are bad combinations, but that's the reality of our system.
But I would also add to that that the other bottom line is there's a lack of data about and a lack of concrete, a lack of concrete solutions. I mean, my read of the state's sea level task force report was that it called must for a lot of research and it that had some ideas, but there wasn't a specific plan for particular neighborhoods or for areas, and it wasn't an implementable plan in terms of it wouldn't have really protected anybody if it had been fully funded. But it would have allowed the process to start, but the data wasn't there also. There's a lot of research that's still needed.
To some extent, yes, it would have started that process, but it would have also put some requirements to the law about the way decisions are made, which is the part that I forgot, Eddie, that you guys, should I say?
No, I had left.
You were gone.
I wasn't there. I was.
But there was a big fight about it. But I don't think we should lose. There are some things that we can do that are free. It doesn't cost anything to change the way you make decisions. Right? It doesn't cost anything to put into the seeker process for you environmental lawyers out there, but you know, to put into the environmental review process climate adaptation as being just as important as the other impacts. So,
talking about hiding bad news, in 2005, the New York Times published an op-ed piece I wrote, and this was just after Katrina, and I titled it, New Orleans Has Drowned, Is New York City Next? And the editor said, Malcolm, you can't do that, it's too provocative. And so they changed the title to A City at Sea, which kind of shocked me as a matter of principle that New York Times would kind of censor, if you like, an op-ed piece, which is just that in somebody's opinion. So that was kind of interesting.
Over here?
Oh, well, she has a mic.
Oh, okay.
I have a question on climate change risk and mitigation measures. In today's Times, it was reported that Governor Cuomo is worrying about climate change risks to New York State's infrastructure. And this relates to the question of how we can mitigate climate change by transitioning more quickly to renewable forms of energy rather than viewing natural gas as a bridge to a low carbon economy. A couple weeks ago, Mark Jacobson, a professor of environmental engineering at Stanford University, released a proposal for powering New York State
with 100% renewable energy by 2030. This relates to electricity generation, heating and cooling, and transportation. And it was reported in the Sunday Review by Elizabeth Rosenthal in her article Beyond Oil and Gas. So my question is, what can we all do to support a more rapid transition to renewable forms of energy and to avoid the natural gas buildout, which unfortunately is being promoted as a cleaner form of energy, even though life cycle assessments of fracking indicate that the greenhouse gas emissions, especially methane, are equal to or greater than that of coal, which means that natural gas is part of the problem and not the solution.
On this panel, I guess we focused a lot on adaptation, but if you want to speak briefly.
Well, yeah, and I don't work on mitigation, unfortunately, but I've studied and I know that I feel like the national solution, which is extremely unpopular, is the carbon tax. I think that's one of the primary ways to get things moving. So that's really all I can probably say without.
Certainly at the law school, we've had a lot of discussions about renewables and financing renewables and use of carbon tax or cap and trade program in other settings. And we will undoubtedly have more. But if people have other questions?
Hi, I'm David. I go to school here at NYU Law. I guess one thing I haven't heard too much discussion about today is preservation as we adapt. I think that despite our international reputation, New York City is actually very much a city in some ways that doesn't like change. I mean, it's a big city and it's a bustling city, but we also have a really strong sense of neighborhoods and a really strong sense of history. I mean, you can't build in Lower Manhattan in a lot of cases without going through a lot of different neighborhood commissions and preservation commissions, and that's not a criticism. I mean, I think it's a deeply ingrained value in the city. And so I'm wondering how we go about adapting to climate change and flood prevention vis-a-vis that value of wanting to preserve our sense of communities and our sense of histories, even preserving our old buildings that are very vulnerable to flooding. I mean, how much, and not only that, we've got all these this probably recalcitrance and reluctance to relocate, but we also got an increase of 15% roughly, or 13% roughly of the population within the next 20 years. I mean, how do you not account for all this historical preservation, this reluctance to relocate, and the desire to, there's the sheer population influx that's coming our way?
Well, one very simple thing that this city can do is change the building code. I mean, the 1 in 100 year risk built in the building code is deeply ingrained in the culture of the city, and I think that's now passé. It should be at least 1 in 250 years. I remember I was doing a National Geographic shoot in the new South Street Ferry subway before it was finished, and I had the chief engineer of the MTA, and I said, "Mr. Engineer, how far above sea level is the entrance up there? We're looking up at the blue sky." And he said, "Oh, it's 11 feet. And I said, "11 feet, that sounds terribly close to sea level." He said, no, it's all safe. It's safe to 100 years storm level. So we know what happened. So it's completely inadequate. So it doesn't solve all the problems. But that culture needs to be changed. I would say this is a very practical one step.
Questions up here?
Hi. Has there been any serious discussions of offshore wind turbines as a way of mitigating surge winds, as well as obviously generating electricity?
I can't speak to the whether it's been. Offshore wind has been talked about now for a few years before storm surge became part of the conversation, but then it runs into the buzzsaw of the Hamptons view or whatever you call it. So there's been a fight that went on for years where there was an offshore wind farm that was being proposed, and some of the folks in the Hamptons and with deep pockets didn't like the idea of wind turbines disturbing their view of the horizon. And they stopped it. I mean, it's just so. But I think there's now a movement afoot to and there's actually a race along the eastern seaboard to look at further out offshore wind turbines. And I think that New York and the New York kind of region, I think, is behind some of the other regions on the eastern seaboard. But Stu, isn't it something you guys started looking at when you were still there? Or
the only actually the offshore wind that that was on the table at the time was in Lake Ontario, not really right. in off the coast. I haven't heard about wind turbines being used as a way of mitigating against storm surge. I don't know.
Well, there was an article published. I'm not sure where it was published, but it's a very academic idea that a huge farm of offshore wind turbines, and we're talking about 50,000 of them, might wow. absorb enough of the wind energy to cut back storm surges. So, you know, it's a sort of, it's almost science fiction in terms of making that a reality. So I'm all for, you know, renewable energy, and many countries do have offshore turbines, and it'll come here. It's just been very slow, and for the reasons that Eddie's talked about.
Okay, well, on that, oh, maybe we'll take one more question and then we'll conclude back there.
I think necessarily the majority of the conversation is centered on public, you know, public efforts and public financing of these projects with little thought that goes to how to engage the private sector to really be thinking about what they can be doing. I mean, there's a lot of money there. There's probably attention if it was pitched the right way. And so as a recent, recently admitted to the bar and beginning my career, how do you encourage real estate developers or people who are making these decisions as these major policy decisions are pending to, you know, I just don't even know where to begin looking at, you know, what agency they need to be thinking about engaging and where does the process go? Do projects just get put on hold between now and
They're being built. Yeah, decisions are being made right now that that may not reflect the most progressive strategies. That's exactly the question that we've asked, and one of our solutions is the Metropolitan Waterfront Alliance is going to be spearheading a program to develop waterfront design guidelines. And from that, a waterfront building council modeled off of the U.S. Building Council to reward developers who go above and beyond what's required for resiliency, for access to the water, for boats and people to access the water, and for restoration, for ecology. So, and the hope is that if that gets put into place, that will also be another impetus to put these requirements into the code and into the regulations over time. So there isn't consensus right now among the agencies. So who you would send a developer to, I think that right now the major agency that would have the most to say and would be most progressively thinking about it actually is Region 2, Department of Environmental Conservation, New York State. They ultimately have the final say in how waterfront projects are developed.
I'll tell you, the private sector is actually very engaged in this issue, not necessarily because there's like great environmental thinking, but because as a practical matter, it is impacting on their business in a big way. So whether if you're an insurance company or a real estate developer where you need to get financing and you're in a vulnerable area, or you have a waterfront business that is looking to expand and you can't get your financing without addressing these issues. So there's lots of ways that the private sector is actually, you know, engaged. Even on the buyouts, there's the reason that some people are going to leave these areas is because they can't get insurance and they can't get mortgages. So they're not going to have a choice. They're going to have to go, which is not very good public policy. But these business decisions and the impacts on business are going to be influencing a lot of the policy decisions that are going to get made.
I would say also that I wouldn't worry about the private sector. The mayor has a climate adaptation task force. They've been around for a few years, and there has been a hazards mitigation model that's been worked on by the mayor's office of sustainability. And real estate is heavily represented there, and they're heavily being engaged with. Just a couple of years ago, the SEC passed a new regulatory a new requirement that for shareholder resolutions that, you know, if you're waterfront-based business, you have to provide for your shareholders your adaptation plans. So the private sector has been on this, and it's been on this for a few years already. And and of course, it's all about the insurance sector. I mean, really, insurance is going to be what's driving all these solutions as we go forward.
Okay, so I'd like to end now, but if the panelists want to just for 5 seconds conclude with one one final thought? You don't feel required to do this, but if you want to take 5 seconds,
sure,
leave us one thought.
I think the thing that a lot of people forget about, but Stu mentioned it, is we need the data. We need the research and the data to tell us, to guide our decisions. I can't explain how important that is and how overlooked it is.
So between the 2100 Commission and the other things the Nature Conservancy has been involved with, I've been thinking about this a lot. And one point, which goes back to my law school days, is to recognize that nature is actually not what's causing the damage. The proximate cause, I hope I'm using that the right way.
I'm teaching torts, yes.
Okay, good. You can correct me if I'm wrong. But the proximate cause are the decisions that we make. The decisions that we make about where we build things, how we build things. That's what has resulted in the damage. And we have an opportunity now, going forward, to be making different kinds of decisions, knowing what we know about the changing climate. And that's the opportunity we really need to seize.
And I would just say law students and recent grads, just, you know, pay attention, because the world has changed. Adaptation, resiliency, nobody was talking about this in you know, outside of the folks involved in the work a few years ago. And now we're telling young people of color in all our neighborhoods, you know, this isn't part of the new language. You have to get, you know, facile with this, right? So pay attention, guys, because it's going to be rebuilding in this town for decades. And hurricane season is just a few months away.
And I hope, as a city, a state, and a nation, we become more proactive in addressing these problems and not just reactive, not just cleaning up the mess after it happens. Forward-looking, progressive, optimistic, and we've sort of become stuck in many ways. It's very discouraging, you know, and the country's lost its confidence in many ways. We've got to get beyond that so we can face the future with good expectations.
Well, thank you very much on that optimistic note. I think it's optimistic. We'll end for today. Thank you.